Good morning.
Good morning.
Well, here we are again. We got the stuff up on the board. Last week, we went over Peter's counsel to husbands and wives. And this week, we want to look at everyone else. Verse 8, finally, it says what?
All of you.
All of you. Who is that? All of you, right? Okay. So finally, all of you, and this is what he expects from the followers of Jesus Christ. Easy to write, easy to read, but really hard to put in practice. That is, finally, all of you be of what?
One mind.
What do you think that means? Donald, how many people do we have here? Have you taken a count yet?
44.
Okay. Have you ever had 44 people be of one mind? So, when Peter writes this, do you think he's just hoping for the best? Or is he writing exhortation to us that we could actually fulfill?
Amen.
How can you get a small congregation of 44 people to be of one mind? How can you get a large congregation of 3,000 people to be of one mind? The answer to that is, let this mind be in you that was in Christ Jesus. So if I have that, and you have that, and you have that, and you have that, and you have that, then we are of
one mind.
Right? So, when you are dealing with people, and you're dealing within a church family, is everybody always going to see things the same way?
No.
So, when it says be of one mind, does it mean we all have to think alike, talk alike, look alike, dress alike?
No.
Always remember that. Because I can read a verse, and Bob can read the same verse, and we see it totally different. But yet we're still called to unity. So within whatever church that you find yourself in, today we're in the Adventist church, but within all of the Christian churches out there, would you say there's unity within the churches?
No.
How do we go from where we're at to what the Bible calls us to where we need to be? See, if you had the answer to that, it would have happened a long time ago, right? But we find ourselves where we're at today because, as I said, easy to write, easy to read, harder to put into practice. Not impossible. How you achieve this is total submission to Jesus Christ. Now, Peter had this in mind, that it's hard to get people to be of one mind. Because this is why he gives this teaching and exhortation. Finally, all of you be of one mind, having what?
Compassion.
What does that word compassion mean?
Tendering pittiness.
Tender-hearted pittiness. I like that. Tenderness one towards another. Now, we live in a very cold, hard world. Is that right? And isn't it the desire of every human being, whether they're good or evil, to find tender and pity somewhere?
Yeah.
Right? What man or woman, having grown up in this world, is not looking for some pity, some tenderness somewhere? This is one of the biggest draws of the church, because that's what you should find within the family of God.
Amen.
Is compassion for one another. So, he goes on to say, have compassion for one another, love as what? Love as brothers. Do you know that the Bible tells you that, actually let me rephrase this. The disciples asked Jesus, actually it was Peter. Peter said to Jesus, I have left everything. What's my reward? What was Peter looking for? What was he looking for?
Love.
What did he say? What's my what?
Reward.
So what was on Peter's mind?
Reward.
He was wondering, what's in this for me? If I've given up everything, what am I going to get? Was he human?
Yeah. Very much.
Okay, so I understand that. And now you better believe that all the other disciples were shaking their heads and their ears were attentive, going, yeah, what is in this for us? And what was Jesus' promise to them? That if you leave family, that you will be repaid 100-fold. Right? 100-fold. He said, in this life you're going to have tribulations, trials, but be of good cheer, for I have overcome this world. Right? So listen. When Peter writes, love as brothers, Peter understood the fulfillment of what Jesus' promise was to him. That if in this life, because you've accepted Christ and you lose your family, you lose your friends, you come into this family called the church, and I haven't met one family that had 44 children.
There you go.
Right?
Praise the Lord.
I met some that were close. But look, you don't see where you could go back when Peter was younger and a young man in the faith and Jesus made this promise that now that he's old, he sees the fulfillment and he's able to write that fulfillment down. I can remember when I joined the Adventist church and I had to leave all of my friends, and I mean all of them. And I came into the church, I didn't know anybody that had any friends within the church. I had some acquaintances, but not a lot of friends. And I can remember telling my wife, I have no friends. I left everything. And wondering, is this worth it? Because it just kept getting harder and harder.
Was it?
Was it worth it?
Yes.
Am I still here? There's your answer. See, because what happened was is that God had to take me from the mindset of Peter when he asked Jesus, I've left everything, what's in it for me? To understanding that if it's just me and you, Jesus, it's worth everything. Everything. And Peter understood that. Listen, can you imagine what it was like for Peter when he first saw Jesus after the resurrection? Ooh. You're excited because he's alive, but then you know, your thoughts start to kick in. It's like, man, the last thing that he saw me do was deny him. And I ran away. You know, he had to face that with the other disciples. That's one thing. But now you have to see Jesus face to face. And on the beach, Jesus asked him once, Peter, do you love me more than these? He said, Lord, you know I love you. And he asked him twice, Peter, do you love me more than these?
Yeah.
Peter's heart's breaking over again. Don't you know I love you? The third time he asked him, how many times did Peter deny Christ?
Three.
And how many times did Jesus ask him, do you love me?
Three.
And you don't think this is all playing in Peter's mind?
Right.
By the third time, Peter's going, Lord, what more can I say? Now listen to this. What's the next thing Peter tells, or Jesus tells Peter? And then after that, he tells him how you're going to die.
Yeah.
Right? Tells him, feed my sheep, feed me. Tells him, this is your future. You follow me, you love me. This is what's going to happen to you. When you were young, you went where you wanted to. But when you're old, they're going to lead you someplace you don't want to go.
Then what was the next word? What about him?
Turns around and sees John and he says, what about him? And Jesus says, well, what happens if he lives until I come? Say, what's that to you? Jesus can be loving and kind and graceful, and sometimes he can be very hard. Very hard to understand and have words that aren't so easy to actually digest and live. But Peter understood that there was nothing better that could be offered him than a relationship with Jesus Christ.
Amen.
And when he was restored to his position, not just as one of the disciples, but as a leader of the disciples.
Amen.
And as a leader of the church, and that God was going to use him in a powerful way. Do you realize that when Peter, in the book of Acts, when Peter would walk down the street, people would bring out the sick, and if his shadow would touch them, they would be healed. Jesus told the disciples, these works you see me doing, you will do these and greater. The shadow of Peter, healing people, right? Now, every time Peter had his ego boosted prior to the crucifixion, did it work out well for him?
No.
Right? And God was able to take this man from that condition to where if his shadow touched you, you were healed. And he was able to be humble and a worker for God. Okay? So, love as brothers. Be what? This is the same thing as having compassion. He's telling you now twice. Be tender-hearted. Why is it important for us to be tender-hearted to each other?
We might need it ourselves one day.
That's a very good answer. It's not might. We will need it ourselves one day. What else, right?
The Bible says, how can we say that we love God when we haven't seen, when we can't even love our brother whom we're looking right at?
That's a good answer as well. Why is it important to be tender-hearted to each other? Because we see the world differently. I see Scripture different from you. I interpret Scripture different from you. My walk with God is different than your walk with God. And we're in the same church. What do? When you deal with people of different religions and different beliefs? You had your hand up?
I was going to say that the world's cruel enough to us, so we have to stick together, if you will. Birds of a feather, you know, we have to
flopped out like
the
that.
Same thing, you know.
Because listen, just like your home, your church should be a safe haven from the world.
Amen.
That you look forward to come here because you're safe. And the people that are sitting next to you love you, and they have your back.
Amen.
And they only want your best. Does that always happen in church?
No.
This is why you have to heed the words of the Scripture. Finally, all of you, be of one mind, having compassion one for another, love as brothers, be tender-hearted, be, what's this next word?
Courteous.
What does the word courteous mean? That is a word that has fallen to the wayside in our day to day. Kind? Right? Allowing another to be first.
Respectful.
Here, respectful. Courtesy. When I was a little kid, my mother taught me that I was to open the door for a lady. That I was to walk on the sidewalk facing the car so that if somebody was going to get hit, it'd be you. Never understood that one, but she said, we do it. Just joking.
You can't, but we want to get hit.
Just joking. Courtesy. That if, like I said, you're coming up to a door and there's a stranger and there's a lady that you open the door for. Well, you know, I've had ladies actually get mad at me for doing that today. Common courtesy. Get upset because I'm courteous. I've had older gentlemen say, why do you call me sir? Well, sir, that's the way I was raised. And it's just going to happen. If you don't like it, I'm sorry, sir.
You get a couple more.
What is missing in our day and age today? Courtesy. Respect. Right? Love. When you get rid of these things, it has a chain reaction and a chain effect. And the world becomes colder, harsher, and darker. And what?
Selfish.
Closed.
Selfish.
Selfish. Those who don't believe in the authority of Scripture, those who don't believe that the Bible is actually for the benefit of society, are reaping what they have sowed.
Amen.
You want to take God out of the public square? This is what you get now.
Yes.
You want to take God out of the schools? These are the kind of children that you get now. If you as a parent want your school to teach your children right from wrong, this is what you get now. Be courteous. Not returning evil for evil or reviling for reviling. We know what evil is. What's reviling? Disrespect? What did you say?
Hate.
Yeah, do not turn hate for hate. Right? So listen. Who's that addressed to? Is that you in your life out in the world?
Yeah.
No. Finally, all of you be of one mind, having compassion for one another. He's talking about your church interactions. Okay? Love as brothers, be tenderhearted and courteous, not returning evil for evil. He's talking about church brethren first. Right? So what's that telling you? It's telling you that inside the church, you may have disagreements. You may have arguments. You may have the splintering of the unity of the church. How do you keep that from happening? By not returning evil for evil. I'm going to ask a question. I want you to be very honest. How many of you have ever been hurt inside the church from church people? Raise your hand. Raise them high, because it's almost unanimous, right? Do you see how many people raise their hand? I can see the ones who did. I don't see too many who didn't. So if you know that those things happen within the church, that we can be hurt deeper within the church than we can outside of that world, you understand what he's talking about here? Not returning evil for evil or reviling for reviling. But on the contrary, if you're treated harshly, if you're treated hatefully, what are you to do? What does that say?
Blessings.
And she had it very correctly, and that is to be nice back. Again, easy to write, easy to read, much harder to live out. Right? This only happens when you are indwelt with the Holy Spirit. When you actually have the mind of Christ in you, then you can have this kind of life within the church. Knowing that you are called to this, what were you called to? You were called to this. You were called to not return evil for evil. You were called to be of one mind. You were called to have compassion. You were called to love as brothers. You were called to be tender-hearted and courteous. Right? Now, even with that calling, you're still going to have people who are going to hurt your feelings. You're still going to have disagreements within the church. You're still going to have disagreements within the brotherhood and the fellowship. And when you have that, then you are told, not the other person, you are told to not return evil for evil. How many of us, when we are treated badly, will only wait for the other person to apologize before we move forward? Ain't nobody raise their hand. Ain't nobody here that does that? Am I the only one? Seriously?
I'm saying like a question.
Ah, thank you. Think about that. When somebody hurts you, what is your natural reaction? Each one of us is different. We deal with these things differently. What is your natural reaction? Do you lash out? Do you wait for that other person? Because, hey, they hurt you. You deserve the apology. But what is the scripture telling you? The scripture is telling you that when these things happen, The responsibility is yours, not theirs, to not return evil for evil, not return reviling for reviling, but on the contrary, that you are to bless your enemies, you are to bless those who spitefully use you, those who persecute you. Knowing that you were called to this, and that if you're called to this and you live by this, you will what?
Inherit a blessing.
Inherit a blessing. That you're not doing it for nothing. There will be a reward, and there's nothing wrong with that. If there was something wrong with that, it wouldn't be through Scripture throughout from beginning to end. The meek will what? What's another word for inherit? Receive. You will receive a blessing. You will inherit a blessing. It is if you are faithful, God is also faithful. This is not for nothing. Now think about this. God has promised us a reward that's going to come in the afterlife, but there's so much more to it than that. That if you submit to Christ, you will get that reward right now. Right now. Right? Jesus told his disciples to go out and preach what? That the kingdom of heaven was at hand. Not it's coming, and it's going to be a really long time, but just be faithful and you may see it. Jesus said the kingdom of heaven is what? Because if you have this mind in you that was in Christ Jesus, then you have that reward now. The fullness of Christ living in you. Have you ever thought about that? How can the purity of God dwell in the impurity of the human heart? I give you a headache.
I think it's in the form of peace of mind and peace of heart.
I do too. I do too. Because he says that if he dwells there, he will change you, and you are not the same. You are what? A new creation. The old has passed, the new has come. Do you realize that you are the only people that really know what the phrase heaven on earth means? You have heaven on earth because you have it dwelling inside you. Okay? So, you are called to this that you may inherit a blessing. For he who would love life and see good days, let him refrain his tongue from evil and his lips from speaking deceit. Let him turn away from evil and do what? Good. Let him seek peace and pursue it. Ray, can you read verse 12?
Sure. For the eyes of the Lord are over the righteous, and his ears are open unto their prayers, but the face of the Lord is against them that do evil.
Do you believe that God watches you?
Amen. Mm-hmm.
Do you believe that God is active in your day-to-day life?
Amen.
Do you believe it when things are hard and you have more questions than you do answers for?
Absolutely.
This is why the church and the fellowship between believers is so important. Because there are days when sometimes I question that. I wonder where God is. What is he doing? I can see what he's not doing. You know what I'm saying? But in the end, like Job,